Even at 99 resistance, I still have one weakness. Hello everyone and welcome. Today I answer the question, can you beat Dark Souls by only leveling resistance? I'm willing to bet that most of you have never put more than one or maybe two levels into this stat, so what even is resistance? Well, it's a pseudo-useless stat, that's what it is. I say pseudo because it does actually do something, mainly poison resistance, but aside from that, it's kind of, well, pointless. Like, if you're trying to build a meta character and have extra points to allocate, pick literally anything else. I'm not even joking, you could be a pure strength main and probably get more benefit out of leveling Faith. So few enemies in this game do poison damage that outside of Blighttown, there's never going to be an instance of you saying, oh darn, I really should have put more levels into resistance. Anyway, now that I've explained a little about how bad it is, let's see what happens if I only level that. I decided to go with the Pyromancer class for two reasons. One, because it is tied with the Wanderer class for having the most base resistance at a whopping 12 points. And two, since I'm not leveling anything else, I'm basically going to have the same restrictions of being at level 1 without actually being at level 1. The Asylum plays out normally, and I'm apparently already resistant to Blunt Force Trauma. I took the Master Key because, let's be honest, it's the only real choice for starting gear, but instead of immediately running all over the place, I head to Undead Burg. I say that like something happened here, but no, it was just a normal everyday trip to the market. I bought the Reinforced Club and the Residence Key. The club will obviously be useful, but the key was mostly just me being on autopilot thinking about the best route through the game. I had decided that from here on out, I was only going to be using melee and resist the temptation to be completely overpowered as a pyromancer. So I figured why not level up my club to a +5 sooner rather than later. Down through the tower, past Havel, the disasters are gone after the defeat of the Gravelord Servant and on to Andre. Wait, hold on, what? I was Gravelorded? Well, that's unexpected, considering my game is set to launch in offline mode. Oh well, nothing a restart won't fix. Anyway, I free Lautrec because I'm a nice guy. I just hope he has a nice trip back to Firelink. Whoa, who left this ring laying around? I better keep it for now. After a bit of farming, my club is now the early game Death Bunker. As such, I thought I would try it out on the gargoyles. The fight took 30 seconds, and I no-hit it, which is cool, I guess? I mean, okay, it is cool, I won't undermine the true GigaChads that actually attempt to no-hit these games, I just didn't feel a sense of accomplishment after doing it. I'm not sure if that's because it was an accident or because the game runs about as fast as a dead snail covered in molasses in a tar pit on a hot day, but either way, with them down and me using a bleed weapon, I thought why not make an early stop to beat up Demonus Thickus over here. Unfortunately, I could not resist the thunderclap of his fat ass, and the shockwave got me, thus forfeiting my no-hit against him. This fight was actually really slow even with a bleed weapon. Maybe I just wasn't capitalizing on the openings more, but it doesn't really matter because he seems to be allergic to turning faster than a broken down merry-go-round, so I just stick to his backside and smack his tail for the better part of 5 minutes. Trading one demon for another, I take on the Bull Boy. Serious question, am I the only one that has problems properly dodging his attacks? Every single one of them seems to have some kind of shockwave, and even after years of playing this game, I just have never been able to roll one of his attacks. Am I just bad or what? Hey there, Solaire, don't worry, you're safe this time. Lemon can't hurt you. Or command me to hurt you. Down in Lower Undead Burg, I free Griggs for literally no reason, as I never spoke to him after this. I'm sorry, what game? What hit me? Did I just take emotional damage from the bandit's disapproving stare? Speaking of weird jank, the Capper Demon was apparently the inspiration for the hitboxes in Dark Souls 2. I have absolutely no idea how that attack didn't connect. My only guess is that I was slightly hunched over from my attack animation, but that's just weird. But it's fine, it's not like there's a boss much later in this run that's known for having stupid hitboxes. Anyway, Capper Demon goes down on the first try. In the depths, I make sure to grab the large ember and free Laurentius. Again, there really wasn't a point in doing this because I never spoke to him, but better than being trapped in a barrel for the rest of his days, I suppose. Next up is the Gaping Dragon, and that sentence is basically all I have to say about this boss. You all know the drill, he slams his face down, you bonk it a couple times, and you just get out of the way. Repeat until you have a tender dragon loin. He does drop the Blighttown key, but that's actually just trash because I always prefer to take the back door. No wait, I didn't mean to like- Making my way back through Firelink, I get the most Dark Souls death I've seen in years. Leave it to me to find a way to die when there's absolutely no danger. Maybe it's karma for all the Lautrex in the canyon, who knows? So for once, I was excited to go to Blighttown because it's literally the only place that this build will shine. Yep, that poison bar sure looks bigger. It was definitely worth it to only level resistance. I couldn't even make it all the way to Quelaag's domain without getting poisoned. It's literally no different than had I not leveled it at all. Well, whatever, maybe at 99 resistance, it'll actually make a difference. But speaking of 99 resistance, I'll need that to resist making a joke about this boss. I don't have 99 resistance. Quelaag hot. Literally. The fight is excruciatingly slow because she has way more health than she needs to, but it's also really easy. I just do the wedge myself between her leg strat and unga bunga until the burning sensation stops. A little further down, I run into Quelaag's sister, the fair lady, but I'm a gentleman, so I won't make any jokes about her. Instead, I'll just make a joke out of her brother, Ceaseless Discharge. 6 slaps to the wrist later and he goes down. Literally. Climbing my way out of Blighttown, I make a quick stop at Andre to buy the Crest of Artorias for later. Yes, I am aware there is a ladder by the Hydro, but convenience has a price and it's 20,000 souls. I wonder how 7-Eleven stays in business with such horrible inflation happening in the soul market. Anyways, on to Sin's Funhouse, which is neither fun nor a house, so I don't really know why I keep calling it that. Whatever, it's a pretty easy walk to the top where I fight the Iron Golem. He's weak to many things, but a small stick with nails in it is not one of them. However, he, like most things, is incredibly vulnerable to gravity. On the Raptors, I also nearly succumb to the Great Tumble, but after performing the world's slowest quit out, I'm fine. I pop a few souls to get enough to plus 10 my club, which, combined with my staggering 52 points of resistance, should absolutely make ONS the easiest boss in the whole game. I lied. They kicked my ass. So the problem isn't the amount of damage I'm doing to the bosses, I mean, don't get me wrong, I'm basically just tickling them, but the real issue is that I couldn't consistently separate them. Like, across all of my attempts, I was just getting the worst luck where they would either both rush me or both cool guy walk at me. On the first try, I thought surely it was just bad luck, but then it continued to happen, and it got to the point where I was wondering if their AI was changed slightly between the remaster and Prepare to Die, because I never had this issue on PTD. Or this is just another case of Doom is bad and blames the game. Anyway, the fight is obviously much easier when they're no longer attached to the hip. I wasn't sure which super form I should do, but honestly, either of them would probably one-shot me, so I went with Super Smo because I'm more comfortable with his moveset. Allow me to show you the amazing flowchart for this boss. Step 1. Stand at mid-range and start running at him. If he shovels, run away. If he jumps, run under him and smack the booty. If he does any other attack, dodge and smack the booty. Step 2. Repeat step 1 until one of you dies. With the dastardly duo defeated, I can go upstairs and use every bit of resistance I have to stop from making any degenerate jokes, which is perhaps the hardest challenge of all. Guinevere gives me the Lord Vessel and tells me to go murder some people, and because she's so nice, I think I will, but first I would like a better weapon. I use some of the souls I have to buy a few Twinkling Titanite, then commit the worst sin I've ever done in this game. Who thought it was a good idea to make him say nighty-night? I already feel like an asshole, no need to kick me while I'm down. Anyway, the Blacksmith Hammer is a really strong weapon, especially for a soul level 1 character, and after a few trays with Snuggly, I have more than enough Twinkling Titanite to max it out. At this point, I was at 53 resistance, and I didn't expect to have enough souls just from bosses to make it all the way to 99, so I figured I would go pick up the Silver Serpent's Ring just for a little boost. I should have done this earlier, but I'm stupid. I get really lucky with a Skull Lantern drop off this Necromancer. I don't exactly need it for the Tomb of the Giants, but I will to get the Silver Pendant later, so it's nice that I don't have to go get the Sunlight Magnet instead. Pinwheel here is a cool little fight where he summons clones and shoots fireballs, and I am definitely not resisting the urge to tell you how easy he is. He dropped the Mask of the Father. I knew if I didn't say what he dropped, you'd all ask. Actually, now that I think about it, ask anyway. Comments are good for the YouTube algorithm. Navigating the darkness, I dropped down and grabbed the ring, but as I was trying to bone out, this Black Knight showed up out of nowhere to ruin my day. Fortunately, all those levels in resistance stopped him from outright murdering me and I got away. I wasn't really ready to take on Nito yet, as I forgot one very important item, so instead I thought why not handle the crazed book dragon, Seath. First, I make sure to grab the broken pendant. Right, you have to kill the Hydro to make the pendant spawn. Okay, I guess I'll do that later then, game. Hey Seath, your breath stinks so bad it could kill a man.
Got him.
I bust out of jail, make my way down the archives while definitely not getting quickscoped by the Chandler, then into Crystal Cave where Cease shows up to tell me that I can't touch his little stick. I get behind him to try and cut off his tail, but he wants to crush me. That's fine when Quelaag does it, but not you, Seath. Unfortunately, he didn't listen, and while I was buried in his tentacle pit, he did the old arena-wide sweep, and my 55 resistance definitely didn't help me out here. Second try, I successfully cut off his tail just because I'm greedy and wanted it, then it's just a matter of hammering his one giant dragon testicle until he goes down. After all that cool blue, I think I could use a little bit of red in my life, so it's back to the demon runes. Since I've already taken care of the Ceaseless Discharge, it's a straight shot to the Demon Fire Sage, where the unbreakable strategy of running behind him comes into play once again, and he goes down easy. Now, however, I did want to test something. Would leveling resistance help reduce lava damage? Right now I'm at 65, which is like 60 more points than anyone should ever have, but that sounds like it should be enough to make some kind of difference, right? Well, sort of? Obviously it's not anywhere enough to completely negate the lava damage, but even if it was, why would you ever pick leveling resistance over just using the ring? But that being said, it does look like it's less damage than normal. Either way, to no one's surprise, I beat up the Centipede Demon, then lava walk my way to Lost Isolith. Now, I'm going to show you how I usually deal with the Bed of Chaos. I think a lot of people do the left side first, but I actually like to do the right side. Since there's no missing floorboard, it's just a straight shot, then do the quit out trick, and when you're back in the arena, hug the wall as closely as you can while heading left. You might think this is a dead end because the floor drops out, but you can actually make this jump if you time it correctly. Or you can just fucking roll to your own death. You can make this jump if you time it correctly. After that, it's just another quit out and run up the branch like normal. Even though this is a pretty easy way to do the fight, you should probably just learn the firebomb strat instead. Believe me, it's a billion times better than just doing the fight normally. With the bed of chaos down, only two Lord Souls remain, but I figured why not take a break from the easy fights and see what kind of fun I can get up to in the DLC. So I take out the Hydro, which means the Golem is now magically holding the pendant, then get Manus handled into the past. First up is the Sanctuary Guardian, who should have been easy, but reminds me exactly what game I'm playing. Today, I learned two new things about this boss. One, he can do a Bronco kick, and two, he doesn't like it when I heal. Anyway, on like the fourth try, he goes down, but that doesn't bode well for the rest of the DLC, but I'm sure it's fine. On my way to Artorias, I wanted to grab the blue Titanite Slab, but the Guardians here had other plans. Oh, I'm alive. Okay then. I don't expect this Artorias fight to go very well. I don't actually have anything to say here, there isn't any crazy strategies, it's just don't get hit and hit back, which to be fair is a strategy for every fight. Either way, Knight Artorias goes down on the third try. Ulysseal is as pleasant as ever. God, I hate this place. Nothing out of the ordinary happens, I just grab the pendant and the crest key, then make my way to the chasm. Here I make sure to save everyone's favorite danger doggo because I'm not a monster, then take on Manus. That's not very much damage. So Manus is the very resistant to both lightning and blunt force trauma, and since those are my only two methods of damage, I'm in for a rough time. The fight isn't hard, I mean sure, it's technically the hardest fight in Dark Souls 1, but after having done it so many times, I know when I'm able to sneak an attack in. The problem really is my lack of damage and lack of health. Fortunately, since leveling up in general will increase your overall defenses, I can take a few more hits than I thought. However, the winning attempt took 10 minutes. I'm not sure I've ever taken that long on a Dark Souls 1 boss before, especially since the last time I fought him was for the one-hit KO video, and that attempt took like 12 seconds. Well, you know, after the 6 or 7 hours of trying. Speaking of that video, I harbor a lot of resentment for you, Dusk, and the desire to strike you down right here, right now, is so tempting. But I can resist.
In truth, how is the old chap, I wonder? Still hammering away, I should hope.
Yeah, I'm sure he's fine. After that very awkward conversation, Go politely shoots Calamine out of the sky, and I can begin the other extremely slow and tedious boss fight in this expansion. Once again, it's not hard, he has several openings, but the one thing I am definitely not a fan of is when I spent 5 minutes slowly whittling down his health, only for the game to give me a massive middle finger and my roll gets carried with his attack into its hitbox, which then staggers me into his follow-up and I die. Thank you, Dark Souls, I hate this game. Whatever, I proceed to bonk him a few more 100 times, and eventually Calamite has Calamet his end. Back in present day, I head through Darkroot Garden to take on Sif, but just before that, I need to deal with the Moonlight Butterfly because I legitimately forgot he existed until now. I think my favorite thing about this boss is just that he floats down. Righto, with the bug squashed, it's time for emotional damage to the boss. The real reason I saved Sif in the DLC was just so I can inflict more sadness upon myself by seeing this cutscene. I do love that they went out of their way to change this scene, but it also makes me really sad that you literally can't not fight her. Like, what if you saved Sif and she knew you were a friend so you could just take the ring? That'd be pretty nice. Also, I know we've all seen it and hate it, but like, really though, what dog-hating jerk thought showing Sif limping and falling over herself was a good decision? I don't care if it's an appeal to emotion, it's too sad. I don't need more depression in my game about depression. Speaking of, the next boss is literally fought in the Void of the Abyss. The four kings are more like the four chumps, as long as you can take them out one at a time. Fortunately, I do just enough damage to safely commit regicide in the allotted time limit. Unfortunately, I'm stupid. On the fifth or so try though, I get some good luck with them not spamming explosions and grab attacks and am able to dethrone the kings. Last up is Gravelord Nito, so I make a quick stop in Interlando to grab the Occult Club, immediately tell Andre about such blasphemy and he downgrades it to the upgraded Divine Club. With this, I can easily dispatch the skeletons and focus all my hammering onto Nito. I wish I had more to say about the big guy, but I find it rather humorous how easy he is for being one of the four lords. Ah well, Bony McBones goes down on the first try. Time for some side bosses. First up, Gwendolyn. I spent more time running at this boss than I did actually fighting him, but really that's pretty par for the course in any Gwendolyn fight. Next, I admire some beautiful artwork before waking up in a strange land. I'm told that the inhabitants are peaceful, but you could have fooled me. Well, hello there, queen. Your seduction magic shan't work on me, for I have many, many resistance. That being said, I can't resist bonking her from behind. For her tail weapon, of course. With every boss sans Gwyn reduced to pulp, I am only at 92 resistance, which sucks because now I have to farm. And eventually, I do it. I hit 99 resistance. I am the most resistant man to ever walk Lordran, and how do I feel? Like I just wasted 80 or so levels, that's how. Like I said at the beginning of the video, resistance is basically useless and its only real benefit is increasing your poison resist stat. So with that in mind, I thought why not put on the best poison resistant gear I have, plus the poison bite ring, and see just how much I can actually resist being poisoned. With a staggering 854 poison resistance, my buildup bar is enormous. This totally wasn't worth it. Blighttown is literally the only place this would have come into play, but unless you go absolutely insane farming, you'll never get to this level of resistance before coming here naturally. I mean, to its credit, I was able to run from Quelaag's domain to this bonfire without the rusted iron ring and still didn't get poisoned, but what's the point? Even if you can do that, poison is such a minor inconvenience that it just doesn't matter. You'd be far better off leveling something more important, like, you know, health. Anyway, it's time to see if I can resist the overwhelming power of the Pleen Pleen Plong. The answer is... maybe? I didn't want to do the SS parry loop, but honestly, even if I had tried, I probably would have failed because two-handing and riposting only sometimes works. On the upside, if I do miss the riposte, then a second hit is enough to temporarily stagger him. My strategy was to try and parry him, and if the riposte was successful, I would do it, walk around him, then smack his butt twice before backing up. It took a few tries, but eventually... oh, hold up, I forgot I need to switch rings, just give it a second. Eventually, the Lord of Sunlight falls and I am faced with the final decision of the run, to link the fire or not. Everyone has told me that this is my destiny, but I can resist the temptation and instead I leave the arena, ushering in an age of darkness. Thank you everyone for watching, and an extra special thanks to my patrons. Stay beautiful, y'all. If you enjoyed the video, please consider giving a like and subscribing. It really helps the channel out, and perhaps you would like to see an actual challenge, maybe the time I beat Dark Souls as Captain Falcon. That was a fun and painful one. But until next time, my friends, don't you dare go hollow. We are here to serve.